Dear students, so far we have seen two lectures on Unit 5, Dynamics of Particles. So the first lecture was about rectilinear motion of particles and the second lecture was on curvilinear motion of particles, or we have seen about projectile motion. So in the first two lectures of Unit 5, so we have discussed about kinematics of particles. Now in this lecture, so we are going to see the next part, that is kinetics of particles. And here we are going to discuss about dynamic equilibrium method. So the contents what we are going to discuss in this lecture are introduction to kinetics. Then we are going to discuss about Newton's law of motion. And in particular, we are going to see about D'Alembert's principle and also some of the applications of D'Alembert's principle. And we are going to see about the motion of connected bodies. And we are going to also see some of the problems on motion of connected bodies using dynamic equilibrium method or D'Alembert's principle. So first let us see what is meant by kinetics. So as we know, in the previous lectures we have discussed about kinematics. So kinematics, there we have studied about the motion of a moving body without considering the forces which cause the motion. So there, in the case of kinematics, we have studied about the relationship between displacement, velocity, acceleration and time of a given motion. But here in the case of kinetics, so we are going to see about the study, or we are going to study about the motion of a moving body by considering the forces which cause the motion. So here in the case of kinetics, we are going to study the relationship between mass and motion of the body. So for this, first let us discuss about Newton's law of motion. So as we know, suppose when a body is at rest, or when a body is moving in a straight line, or it may be a curved line also. So that particular body will obey certain laws of motion, and those laws of motion are called as Newton's law of motion. So whenever a body is at rest, or when it is moving in a straight line or curved line, it obeys certain laws, and those laws are called as Newton's law of motion. So before discussing in detail about Newton's laws of motion, so we'll see some of the basic definitions involved in the Newton's laws of motion. So the first definition is mass, so which we have discussed in the introduction class of engineering mechanics itself. So mass is nothing but the quantity of matter contained in a body. So the unit of mass is kilogram. It is represented as m, and the unit of mass is kilogram. And weight, so weight is nothing but a force. So weight is nothing but the force by which the body is attracted towards the center of the earth. So it is something related to gravity. Here the weight can be represented as W. So W can be written as m into g, where m is the mass of the body and g is the acceleration due to gravity. You know that the unit of mass is kilogram, and the value for unit for g is meter per second square. That is, acceleration due to gravity is expressed in meter per second square. So kg into meter per second square. So that is nothing but Newton. Therefore 1 Newton is equal to 1 kg meter per second square. Then another definition is momentum. So it is nothing but the product of mass and velocity. So momentum can be written in equation form as m into v. So unit for mass is kilogram, and unit for velocity is meter per second. Therefore the unit for momentum is kg meter per second. Now let us see about the Newton's laws of motion. So we have three laws, as we know: Newton's first law, Newton's second law and Newton's third law. So first let us see about Newton's first law, and this particular law is also called as law of inertia. So here this is the statement of Newton's first law. So every body continues in its state of rest or of uniform motion in a straight line unless it is acted upon by some external force. So that means that if you don't have any external force acting on the body, so the body which is already in the state of rest will be at rest, and similarly a body which is in motion already in a straight line, it will continue its motion in a straight line. So unless it is acted upon by some external force. So that is the Newton's first law statement. And this law is also called as law of inertia. And so suppose if a body is at rest, so the body at rest has a tendency to remain at rest. So it is called as inertia of rest. Suppose if a body is in motion, a body in uniform motion in a straight line has a tendency to preserve its motion. It is called inertia of motion. So here the Newton's first law, it talks about both the bodies which are in rest as well as which are in motion. So it states that if you don't have any external force, then the body which will be already in rest will remain to be at rest. So this is called as inertia of rest. And suppose if the body is in motion already in a straight line, then the body has a tendency to preserve its motion. So it is called as inertia of motion. Now, before seeing the Newton's second law, let us first discuss about Newton's third law. So Newton's third law, so as we know, so for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. So that is a statement of Newton's third law. And coming to the Newton's second law, so it is also called as law of dynamics. So this is the statement of Newton's second law. The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force and takes place in the same direction in which the force acts. So in the last slide, so we have seen about the definition of momentum. So it's nothing but the product of mass and velocity. So here, according to the statement of Newton's second law, the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force and it takes place in the same direction in which the force acts. Now you have some simple derivation for this Newton's second law of motion. So for that, we consider a body of mass m. Now let u be the initial velocity of the body and v is the final velocity of the body. And a is the constant acceleration and t is nothing but the time taken by the body to change its velocity from u to v. That is from initial velocity to the final velocity. It will take some time. So that time is t. And f is nothing but the force required to change velocity from u to v in time t seconds. Now, we know the definition of momentum, which is product of mass into velocity. So from that, we calculate the initial momentum, which is nothing but the product of mass and the initial velocity, that is m into u. Similarly, the final momentum can be calculated from m into v, where v is the final velocity. Now, we calculate the rate of change of momentum. So rate of change of momentum is nothing but, so here we mean rate of change of momentum. So the change of momentum with respect to time that we have to find out. So that is nothing but the final momentum minus initial momentum divided by time t. So when you simplify this, you get m into v minus u divided by t. So since we know the basic equation of motion, v is equal to u plus at. Therefore, a will be equal to v minus u divided by t. So this v minus u divided by t will become now a. Therefore, the rate of change of momentum will now become m into a. So according to the Newton's second law of motion, the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force. Therefore, we know F is proportional to m into a. So this m into a is nothing but rate of change of momentum. So it's directly proportional to the impressed force according to Newton's second law. Therefore, F is proportional to m into a, which is equal to k into ma. So here this k is called as constant of proportionality. Now we know that F is equal to m into a. That means that when a body of mass 1 kg is moving with an acceleration of 1 meter per second square, then the force acting on a body will be equal to 1 Newton. So that is the meaning of this equation, F is equal to m into a. That is, if you have a body of mass 1 kg, suppose if it is moving with an acceleration of 1 meter per second square, then the force acting on the body will be equal to 1 Newton. So that's why we get F is equal to m into a. Now we'll see another important principle, which is the application of Newton's second law of motion, which is called as D'Alembert's principle. So it is important application of Newton's second law of motion. So we know about Newton's second law of motion. It is nothing but the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force. So from which we got an equation F is equal to m into a. Now this D'Alembert's principle is used to convert the dynamics problem into a static problem. So now, according to the statement of D'Alembert, so it states that the system of forces acting on a body in motion is in dynamic equilibrium with the inertia force of the body. Suppose if you have a body which is in motion and if your body is subjected to system of forces. So sometimes a body may be subjected to a single force or sometimes the body may be subjected to more than one force, we call it as a system of forces. So here if you can see, this particular body is subjected to three forces, F1, F2, F3. So this F1, F2, F3, they constitute the system of forces. Now you consider that this body is in a motion. So now if you have the system of forces like this on a moving body, suppose if the body is moving with an acceleration A, now this particular body will be in dynamic equilibrium So when you have the inertia force acting on the body, so this inertia force is represented as ma. So according to the Newton's second law of motion, we have F is equal to m into a. But here we have system of forces, we have more than one force, therefore here summation of F. So summation of F will be equal to ma. So this is as per the Newton's second law of motion. So this equation is called as equation of dynamics. And it is also called as law of dynamics, because your Newton's second law of motion, it's also called as law of dynamics. So this particular equation, we call it as equation of dynamics. Now, this particular problem can be converted into a static problem like this. Now, if you bring this ma to left hand side, what you'll get, summation f minus ma equal to 0. So now this will become equation of statics, or we can also call it as dynamic equilibrium equation. That means that if you have a body with system of forces, so summation f is nothing but the resultant of the given forces, and if to that resultant, if you add an inertia force ma, that is summation f minus ma, so you add that particular inertia force in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion of the body, therefore summation f minus ma, you'll become 0. Therefore summation f minus ma is equal to 0. Now this has become equation of statics, or it is also called as dynamic equilibrium equation. So if you have the, if you add the inertia force to the resultant force, your body will be in a condition of dynamic equilibrium. So that's a statement of D'Alembert. It states that the system of forces acting on your body in motion is in dynamic equilibrium with the inertia force of the body. So if you have the inertia force acting on the body, then the body will be in a state of dynamic equilibrium condition. Now let us see about the direction of the inertia force. So you please look at this figure. So you have a block of self weight W, which is resting on an inclined plane. So here the direction of the motion is marked like this. Therefore the inertia force will be acting in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. And similarly, here you have a tension T, and the direction of the motion is in this direction, whereas your inertia force will be acting opposite to the direction of the motion like this. So you can simply define the inertia force as the resistance offered by a body to change in its state of rest or of uniform motion. Therefore, you always remember the inertia force ma will be acting in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. Now let us discuss about the motion of connected bodies. So we know practically, in practical applications, so we don't have a single body, so we will have a combination of two or more bodies. So these bodies normally will be connected by cables, strings or wires or cords, and here the tension acting on those cables will be constant throughout its length. So in many of the practical applications, we'll come across a combination of we'll come across a system, so where two or more bodies will be connected by either cables or strings or wires or cords, and sometimes we have the pulleys also. Normally the pulleys are used to change the direction of the motion. And here while solving the problems, we used to neglect the mass of the pulleys, because the mass of the pulleys will be very small. Therefore while solving the problems, normally we used to neglect the mass of the pulleys, and always we assume that the pulleys are smooth. So if you want to analyze the motion of connected bodies with the help of D'Alembert's principle, so the first thing what we have to do is, you have to draw the free body diagram of each body separately. Suppose if you have more than one body involved in the system, so you have to draw the free body diagram of each body separately, and in the free body diagram you have to mark all the forces acting on the body. And while drawing the free body diagram, so you have to mark the inertial force also. So as we know, the inertia force will be acting in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So the first step is, we have to draw the free body diagram of each body, and in the free body diagram we have to mark all the forces acting on the body including the inertial force, and the direction of the inertial force will be in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. And after drawing the free body diagram, we have to apply the equations of equilibrium. So we know that summation fx equal to 0 and summation fy equal to 0. So those equations of equilibrium ought to be applied for solving the free body diagram. And suppose if your body is resting on a rough surface, then there the frictional force also will come into effect. So in addition to the inertia force, suppose if your body is resting on a rough surface, then in that case the frictional resistance is also to be considered. Now let us try to solve some of the problems using D'Alembert's principle. So the first problem is, a block of mass 50 kg resting on a horizontal plane is required to be given an acceleration of 2 meter per second square towards right by applying a push P at an angle of 45 degree with the horizontal, assuming that the coefficient of friction between the block and plane is 0.4, find the magnitude of the force P. So you have a block of weight 50 kg, so it's resting on a horizontal plane, and you have a applied force P which is applied at an angle of 45 degree with the horizontal. And the coefficient of friction between the block and the plane is given, which is 0.4. And for this condition, you have to get the magnitude of the force P. So that is the question. Now, so since it is an inclined force, first thing is you can dissolve this force into two components, P cos 45 and P sin 45. So again, the self weight of the block we can mark. So this weight of the block given is 50 kg. You have to convert that to Newton. So 50 into 9.81. So therefore we get a self weight of the block as 490.5 Newton. So this is the free body diagram, and we are marking all the forces acting on this body. So first, the incline force. So that has been resolved into a horizontal component and a vertical component. And you have a self weight, so which we have calculated like this. So 490.5 is the self weight. Since you have the horizontal force acting in this direction, therefore inertial force will be acting in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So you can see here the direction of the inertia force. The applied force is in this direction, therefore the inertia force is in this direction. And since the block is in contact with the surface, you have the frictional force also. The coefficient of friction is given. Again, the frictional force you have to mark in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion, or you can say the direction of the inertial force and the direction of the frictional force will be same. So we know that the frictional force is mu into R, that is normal reaction. F is equal to mu into R. So mu is 0.4, therefore 0.4 into R. And since this block is in contact with the surface, you have the normal reaction R, so which is marked here. So this is the free body diagram. Once again, I'm repeating. So you have the applied force P, which is resolved into two components, P cos 45 and P sin 45. Then you have the inertia force acting opposite to the direction of the motion. Then you have the self weight. Then you have the normal reaction R. Then you have the frictional force F is equal to mu into R. So this is the free body diagram of the system. So now knowing this free body diagram, so we have to apply the equations of equilibrium. Now this is the free body diagram again, so which is shown here. So now we are applying the equations of equilibrium, summation fx equal to 0. So when you resolve all the forces acting in the x direction, so you have P cos 45, then minus 0.4 R, then minus MA is equal to 0. So when you solve this, you get equation 1. Similarly, if you apply summation fy equal to 0, you have minus P sin 45, then minus W, that is self weight, then plus R is equal to 0. So this is the equation. So now you get two equations, 1 and 2. When you solve those two equations, you will get the value of the P as 698.15 Newton. Now let us move to the second problem. So you have two blocks of mass 280 kg and 420 kg, and they are connected as shown in the figure. Assume that the pulley is frictionless and mu is equal to 0.3 between the block A and the surface. Find the acceleration and the tension in the string. So now here you have the two blocks. The weight of the first block, that is block A, is 280 kg and the weight of the block B is 420 kg. They are connected together by means of a pulley, and the pulley is frictionless. Therefore, you don't have the friction here. And the coefficient of friction between the block A and the surface is given, which is 0.3. So this is in contact with the surface, whereas this particular block is hanging freely like this. Now, we are going to draw the free body diagram of each block. Now let us consider this block first, that is 420 kg block. So if you take this block separately, so you have the self weight. So self weight is marked here, 420 into 9.81 to convert it into Newton. So this is the self weight of the block. Now this block will move in this direction. Therefore, your inertia force will be acting in this direction. And since it is connected by a cable like this or a string like this, so you have the tension in the string which is marked here. So this is the free body diagram. It's very simple. So you have the self weight, you have the tension in the string, and you have the inertia force. Since the block is going to move downwards, your inertia force will be moving, will be acting in the upward direction. Now when you apply summation Fy equal to 0, so you'll get plus T plus Ma minus the self weight. So you'll get an equation like this. So this is the first equation. Now let us consider the free body diagram of 280 kg block. So you have the 280 kg block, the self weight is marked like this, and the normal reaction is marked like this, and you have the tension in the string which is marked as T, and you have the inertia force Ma and also the frictional force mu into R which is marked in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So when you apply summation Fx equal to 0, we get T minus Fa minus 0.3 R is equal to 0. Similarly, when you apply summation Fy equal to 0, you have R minus this is equal to 0. From this, the R value is taken as this. Now we are substituting this R value back in this equation 2. So we get an equation like this. Now from the free body diagram of the first block, already we have got equation 1. And now you have this equation 3. When you solve this equation 1 and 3, so we can get the value of tension in the string as 2142.5 Newton and the acceleration of the block as 4.71 meter per second square. Now let us move on to the third problem. So here you have a body which is resting on an inclined plane. So a body weighing 1200 Newton is resting on a rough plane inclined at 20 degree to the horizontal as shown in figure. It is pulled up the plane from rest by means of a light flexible rope running parallel to the plane and passing over a light frictionless pulley at the top of the plane. The portion of the rope beyond the pulley hangs vertically and carries a weight of 800 Newton at the end. If the coefficient of friction for the plane and the body is 0.2, find tension in the rope, acceleration of the body, and the distance moved by the body in 3 seconds, starting from rest. So that is the question. So you have a body of weight 1200 Newton, which is resting on an inclined plane, and the angle of inclination of the plane is given as 20 degree. And this body is pulled upwards, so by means of a rope, and this rope is running parallel to the plane, and it is passing over a pulley, it's a frictionless pulley, and through the pulley you have a weight of 800 Newton which is hanging like this at the end, and the coefficient of friction between the body and the plane is 0.2, so you have to find the tension in the rope and acceleration of the block. And also you have to find the distance moved by the body in 3 seconds when it starts from rest. So that is the question. Now again we have to start from the free body diagram of the blocks. So now you consider this block 800 Newton. So the free body diagram of this block is very simple. You have simply self weight and you have the inertia force which is acting. So since your block is going to move downwards, inertia force will be moving, will be acting upwards. And since it is connected by a rope, you have the tension in the rope that is indicated as T. Now from this free body diagram we are applying summation Fy equal to 0. So from this we get T minus this then plus Ma is equal to 0. So we get an equation like this. Now consider the free body diagram of 1200 Newton weight block. So this block is resting on an inclined plane and the angle of inclination of the plane is 20 degrees. So you can see here the self weight is marked like this. So when you resolve this self weight into two components, so one along the plane and another one perpendicular to the plane. So when you resolve this self weight along the plane, you have 1200 sine 20. And similarly, if you resolve this self weight perpendicular to the plane, you have 1200 cos 20. So now we are going to apply summation Fx equal to 0. So now the x direction is nothing but the direction which is parallel to the plane. So if you see the other forces which are marked here, and since the block is resting on an inclined surface, you have the normal reaction which is acting perpendicular to the surface of the contact. So this normal reaction is marked as capital R. So this is nothing but the normal reaction since it is resting on a surface. So the reaction of the surface is R. And since the block is going to move towards right, your inertia force will be acting in this direction. Similarly, the frictional force will also be acting in the direction opposite to the direction of the motion. In addition to that, since you have the rope here, you have the tension in the rope T. So this is the free body diagram. You have the self weight, which is resolved one along the plane and one perpendicular to the plane like this. Then you have the tension in the rope. Then you have the normal reaction R. Then you have the inertia force MA. Then you have the frictional force mu into R. Now with this, we are applying the equations of equilibrium, summation Fx equal to 0 and summation Fy equal to 0. So from summation Fy equal to 0, we can get the direction of the R directly. That is, we can get the value of the normal reaction directly. And when you apply summation Fx equal to 0, we get an equation like this. Now after knowing this normal reaction, we can substitute back in this equation. Now already we have equation 1. When you solve both equations, you get the tension in the rope as 734.38 and the acceleration is 0.8 meter per second square. Another equation is you have to find out the distance moved by the blocks at time t equal to 3 seconds. So for this, we are making use of the distance equation. It is s is equal to ut plus half at square. So since it is starts from rest in the question, it is given that it is starting from rest. Therefore, initial velocity is equal to 0. Time t equal to 3 seconds. So this will become 0. Then acceleration half into acceleration of the block is 0.8 meter per second square. Then time t is 3 seconds. When you substitute all the values, we get the distance is 3.6 meters. Now coming to the next problem. So you have two blocks of mass 20 kg and 40 kg. They are connected by a rope passing over a frictionless pulley as shown in figure 5.37. Assuming the coefficient of friction is 0.3 for all the contact surfaces, find the tension in the string and the acceleration of the system. Also compute the velocity of the system after 4 seconds starting from the rest. So now here the problem is you have both the blocks which are resting on an inclined plane. So the first block, it is resting on an inclined plane and the angle of inclination is 30 degree. Whereas the second block, if you can see, the angle of inclination is 60 degree. Now the coefficient of friction is given as 0.3. So you have to find the tension in the string and also the acceleration of the system. And you also need to calculate the velocity after 4 seconds starting from rest. So for that again, we start from the free body diagram. So we take this 20 kg block. So we are going to draw the free body diagram here. So if you take this 20 kg block, the self weight, again you have to convert this kg to Newton. So 20 into 9.81, you get 196.2. So it is marked like this. Again, that can be resolved into two components, one along the plane and one perpendicular to the plane. So 196.2 sine 30 and similarly 196.2 cos 30. So this 30 is nothing but the angle of inclination of the plane. Now, since this 40 kg block, now we assume that the block is, this particular block is going to move up the plane and the block B is going to move down the plane. So now for this block, the movement will be like this. Therefore, the inertia force will be like this. Similarly, your frictional force will be like this. And similarly, the tension is marked here, T. Now we are going to apply the equations of equilibrium. So after applying summation Fx equal to 0, we get an equation like this. Similarly, when you apply summation Fy equal to 0, you get an equation like this. Now this Ra is nothing but the normal reaction of the block A. So after getting this Ra, we can substitute back in the equation to get a equation involving T and A. Now let us move to the free body diagram of 40 kg block. Again, if you convert that 40 kg into Newton, you get 392.4. That can be resolved again one along the plane and one perpendicular to the plane. So along the plane, the self weight is 392.4 cos 60. Because there, for the second block, the angle of inclination is 60 degree. And here, one perpendicular to the plane, the self weight is resolved as 392.4 sine 60. And since this block is going to move downwards, your frictional force will be acting upwards. Similarly, inertia force will be acting upwards. And since it is connected by the string also, the tension of the string is marked like this. So for this block also, now we are going to apply summation fx equal to 0 and summation fy equal to 0. So when you apply summation fx equal to 0, it is nothing but the force in this direction. So that is along the plane, along the plane. So if you resolve along the plane, you get 392.4 sine 60, then minus t minus ma, then you have the frictional force 0.3 rb. So everything comes here. Similarly, when you apply fy equal to 0, that is in this direction, so you have the rb, which is nothing but the normal reaction of the block B. Then you have this force also. So rb, then you have this force also, 392.4 cos 60. So from this you get the rb directly. So after getting the rb, so you can substitute back in this equation to get an equation in terms of t and a. So you have already one equation involving t and a. So when you solve those two equations, you can get the value of t and acceleration. So again, after getting the rb value, after substituting, we get an equation 4 like this. So when you solve equations 2 and 4, you get the tension as well as acceleration as this. Now you need to find the velocity of the block. So after t, again time t seconds, it's starting from rest. Again, initial velocity will be equal to 0. So the final velocity is equal to u plus at. Initial velocity is 0, acceleration is known 2.2, and time is given. From this you get the final velocity of the block as 8.79 meter per second. Now the next problem is, you have two blocks A and B of weight 60 Newton and 40 Newton, which are connected by a string passing through a smooth pulley as shown in figure. Calculate the acceleration of the system and the tension in the string. So this is the system which is given. You have the two blocks 60 Newton and 40 Newton, which is connected or which is passing over a smooth pulley like this. So in this case, you have to find the tension in the string and also you have to calculate the acceleration of the system. Now the acceleration, let us take the acceleration as A and the tension in the string as T. So since the string is passing over a smooth pulley, the tension in the string in both sides will be equal. Now if you compare the weights of the block, so this is 60 Newton, this is 40 Newton. Therefore this 60 Newton block is going to move downwards and this 40 Newton block is going to move forwards. So these are the directions of the blocks. Now consider this block first, 60 Newton block. So when you draw the free body diagram, you have the self weight 60 Newton which is marked here and you have the tension T which is marked here. And since this block is going to move downwards because of its weight, your inertia force will be acting upwards. Now for this free body, we apply summation Fy equal to 0. So we get an equation like this. Now let us consider the free body diagram of the 40 Newton block, which is going to move upward. Therefore the inertia force will be acting downwards here. This is the self weight and again this is the tension in the string. So now we are applying summation Fy equal to 0. So we get a simple equation, that is T minus MA minus 40 equal to 0. So when you solve the equations 1 and 2, you get the tension as 48 Newton. The acceleration is 1.96 meter per second square. So this is very simple. We have drawn the free body diagrams of the two blocks and we have applied the equations of equilibrium to solve for the tension T and the acceleration A. Now let us move on to the next problem. Two weights 800 Newton and 200 Newton are connected by a thread and move along a rough horizontal plane under the action of force 400 Newton applied to the first weight of 800 Newton as shown in figure. The coefficient of friction between the sliding surfaces of the weights and the plane is 0.3. Determine the acceleration of the weights and the tension in the thread using D'Alembert's principle. So here you have the two blocks which are both resting on a horizontal plane and you have a force of 400 Newton which is acting in the block of weight 800 Newton and the coefficients of friction are given 0.3. So by applying D'Alembert's principle, we have to find the acceleration of the blocks and also the tension in the thread. Now let us the free body diagram. Now let us consider the 800 Newton block. So here if you draw the free body diagram of the 800 Newton block, so you have the applied force here, so 400 Newton. So because of this applied force, your block will move in this direction. Therefore, the inertia force as well as the frictional force will be acting opposite to the direction of the applied force. And since it is resting on the horizontal surface, you have the normal reaction. So that is marked as R1. Then you have the self weight of the block 800. So now we are applying equations of equilibrium, summation fx equal to 0. So from this we get 400 minus 0.3 R1 minus T. Then you have minus MA. So now here M is the mass. So here we are converting that into kg. So 800 is given in Newton. So 800 divided by 9.81. Similarly, when you apply summation Fy equal to 0, you have R1 minus 800 is equal to 0. From that we get R1. After getting the value of R1, you can substitute back in this equation to get an equation in terms of T and A. Similarly, free body diagram of the 200 Newton block. So here you can see the self weight 200 Newton, which is marked here. And again, it is connected by a string. Therefore, the tension is marked here. And the normal reaction of this particular block is shown as R2, which is marked here. And since the block is going to move in this direction, both your frictional force and the inertia force and the frictional force will be acting in this direction. Now you apply summation fx equal to 0. You get T minus 0.3 R2 minus MA equal to 0. Again, the weight is given 200 Newton. You have to convert it into mass. So 200 divided by 9.81. So you have here you have to note this. Similarly, if you apply summation Fy equal to 0, you have R2 minus 200 is equal to 0. So from this, you can get the R2 directly as 200. After substituting the R2 value here in this equation, we get an equation in terms of T and A. So from the first block, you already have one equation involving T and A. So this is another equation. So if you solve both the equations, you get the value of T as 80 Newton and the acceleration is 0.98 meter per second square. Now this is another interesting problem. So you have two blocks of weights 500 Newton and 1000 Newton, which are shown in figure. The coefficient of friction between the 500 Newton block and the inclined plane is given as 0.3. So you have to find the acceleration of the block and the tension in the string. Now, so you can see here, you have the 500 Newton block, which is supported by a single string. Whereas if you take this 1000 Newton block, it is supported by two strings. The strain on, when you can see here, you have the strings on either side. So, but the total length of the string is constant. So, if you see this SA, that is the length of this particular string, and you have two SB, is equal to constant. So, the total length of the string is constant. So, SA, length of the string, similarly SB, SB. So, SA plus 2SB is equal to C. So when you is equal to C, it's nothing but a constant. So when you differentiate this, you know that rate of change of displacement is velocity. So you have VA plus 2VB is equal to 0. So this is the equation. So you please understand here, you have a 500 Newton block, which is supported by a single string. And you have the 1000 Newton block, which is supported by the two strings. We have the strings on either side. But the total length of the string is constant. That is SK plus SB plus SB is equal to constant. Therefore, SA plus 2SB is equal to constant. When you differentiate this, you get velocity VA plus 2VB is equal to 0. Because the rate of change of displacement is velocity. So, VA plus 2VB is equal to 0. And similarly, therefore, you have the acceleration also. AA plus 2AB is equal to 0. So, AA is nothing but the acceleration of the block A and AB is nothing but the acceleration of the block B. So, we can establish a relation between the acceleration of the two blocks. So, from this we get the acceleration of the block A is equal to minus 2 times the acceleration of the block B. Now, let us consider the free body diagrams of the blocks. So, you have a block in a 500 Newton block which is resting on an inclined plane. So, you can see the free body diagram here. You have the self weight. Again, this self weight can be resolved into two components. One along the plane, one perpendicular to the plane. So, along the plane, the component is 500 sine 30. And perpendicular to the plane, the component is 500 cos 30. So, this 30 is nothing but the angle of inclination of the plane. And this T is nothing but the tension of the string. And R is the normal reaction of the surface. And you can see here the frictional force and the So, the frictional force is marked here. Similarly, the inertia force is marked here. And since the movement of the block will be in the upward direction, both the inertia force and the frictional force will be in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion of the block. So since this block is moving upwards, you please be clear, your inertia force and the frictional force will be acting downwards. Now with this, we are applying summation fx equal to 0. So fx is nothing but, the x direction is nothing but along the inclined plane, in the direction parallel to the inclined plane. So you can see t minus 0.3 r, then minus 500 sine 30, then minus m into AA, that is m is nothing but 500 divided by 9.81. We are converting that into weight into AA, that is acceleration of the block A. So you get one equation. Similarly, when you apply summation Fy equal to 0, you have r minus 500 cos 30 is equal to 0. From this r is equal to this. You substitute this r back in this equation. So you get t is equal to this. The next block, that is 1000 Newton block. So you can see here, you have the two strings here. So which is marked as T. So you have one string, another string. So the tension in the string is marked as T. And this block is going to move downwards, your inertia force will be moving upwards. There is no frictional force here because this block is not in contact with any surface or so. Therefore, you simply have the inertia force. So since the block is moving downwards, the inertia force will be acting upwards. Inertia force is the mass of the block B into acceleration of the block B, MB into AB. Now you apply simply the summation Fy equal to 0 because here all the forces acting in the y direction. Therefore, 2t minus 1000 minus this. Again, this mass, you have to convert that weight to mass by dividing 9.81. So you get an equation like this. Now when you solve the equations 2 and 3, we get the tension in the string as this. And acceleration of the block AA is this. And here, instead of this AB, we are substituting the relationship. Because we know that acceleration of the block A is 2 times the acceleration of the block B, or AB is AA by 2. So we are substituting that relationship here. That's why we get an equation in terms of AA. So the equation 2 also we get in terms of T and AA. So when you solve equation 2 and 3, we get tension as this and acceleration as this. The acceleration of the block is given as this. Now let us see the last problem in D'Alembert's principle. So you have a block 18 Newton which is pulled up on a smooth plane by a force P as shown in figure. Determine the acceleration along the plane. So it's a very simple problem. You have the block which is resting on an inclined plane and you have a force, that is applied force P, which is 75 kilonewton, and this force is acting at an angle of 15 degrees with the horizontal. So now this is the question. You have to find the acceleration along the plane. So just we have to draw the free body diagram. So this block, you take it out and you mark the self weight of 80 newton and the angle of inclination of the plane is 35 degree. Therefore this self weight can be resolved into two. One is along the plane and one is perpendicular to the plane. So along the plane, it is 80 sine 35. And perpendicular to the plane, it is 80 cos 35. And since the block is pulled up by this force, both the inertia force and the frictional force will be acting in the downward direction. But here, since the coefficient of friction is not given, so you can neglect the friction. So simply you have the inertia force. So again, normal reaction you have, since it is in contact with the surface, you have the normal reaction R, which is marked here. So simply, again, the applied force can be resolved into two components, 75 cos 15 and 75 sin 15. So this is the free body diagram. So simply, you have the self weight, which is resolved into two components along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. And you have the inertia force acting in this direction, since the block is going to move upwards. Then the applied force can be resolved into two components. One is horizontal, another one is vertical. Then you have the normal reaction R. Now simply you apply the equations of equilibrium, summation Fx equal to 0. So summation Fx equal to 0, if you apply, that is x direction is nothing but the direction along the plane. So when you apply summation Fx equal to 0, you have 75 cos 15. Then you have this also, minus 80 sin 35. Then you have minus MA. So instead of mass, again it is given in kilonewton. So you have to convert that to, here it is given in Newton, you have to convert that to kg. So mass divided by 9.81. So when you apply summation fx equal to 0, you can directly get the acceleration as 3.26 meter per second square. Similarly, in order to get the normal reaction, you apply summation fy equal to 0. So when you apply summation fy equal to 0, r minus 80 cos 35, then you have plus 75 sin 15 is equal to 0. From this equation, we can get r is equal to 46.12 newton. So far we have seen problems on motion of connected bodies using D'Alembert's principle, that is the application of Newton's second law of motion. So while solving those problems, we have drawn the free body diagrams of each body separately, and we have applied the equations of equilibrium for each of the bodies. And the most important thing is that while you apply the D'Alembert's principle, you have to consider the inertia force also in the system. And always you please make a note that the direction of the inertia force, that is M into A, will be in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So whenever you have the connected bodies, that is whenever you have a system involving more than one body, so you have to draw the free body diagram of each body separately, and you have to apply the equations of equilibrium. So please don't forget, when you apply D'Alembert's principle, please don't forget to include the inertia force, that is M into A, in the free body diagram. So always you have to mark the inertia force in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So for this, I have referred these textbooks for my lecture. Thank you.